Welcome to this NPTEL Lectures on Robotics, Basics and Advanced Concepts. We are looking at redundancy in robots and how to resolve this redundancy. Okay, in the last two lectures, we looked at hyper-redundant robots and also we looked at the human arm and saw what the redundancy is used in human arm for. Okay, in this lecture, we'll look at a flexible robot which is made to be extremely redundant. Okay, so what can we, or how do we resolve the redundancy in flexible robots? Okay, so quick acknowledgement. This is the work of Ashwin and Soumyakanti Mahapatra, students in our robotics lab, and the main funding is from the Robert Bosch Center for Cyber-Physical Systems. So the contents of this talk are introduction. Then we will look at a place where there is extreme flexibility. Okay, so this is in an endoscope. So we will look at endoscopy and flexible robots. Then we will look at what are called as miniaturized pneumatic artificial muscles. And then we will see how we can use this miniaturized pneumatic artificial muscles to make an actuated flexible endoscopic end effectors. And then we will look at cable driven robots and finally conclude this presentation. So what is an endoscope? So basically it is defined, it is a thin flexible telescope. Okay, that is the way it is understood. So what it is that you have this long cable-like structure. It is very flexible. At the tip of the endoscope, there is a light and a camera. Okay. So the idea is that you send this device through your mouth, through your GI tract, into the stomach region, and then you can take pictures. Okay, so this flexible tube with instruments and control is inserted through the mouth into the GI tract. Okay, similar thing is also used to insert in your colon for colonoscopy. Okay, so what is the purpose? The purpose is this flexible tube has a camera and some light at the end, and you can take pictures of what is happening in your stomach. So if you have cancer or if you have ulcers, you can take pictures, and then the doctor can figure out how to treat you properly. Okay, so this is an extremely flexible tube. So we want to look at how to model these things. So in one of the lectures earlier, I had shown you how we can model it using Tractrix based algorithm, discretized into small pieces, and show how this endoscope can move inside your GI tract. In this, we are looking at the end of the endoscope, basically. So we want to look at how we can add something to the endoscope to make it more useful. And that will be a flexible robot. Okay. So let's quickly go back and see what is an endoscope. Basically, as I said, it's a flexible tube of length of approximately 1.5 meters. Okay. There is a connecting umbilical cord which connects to the light source and air supply. There are these control heads, so two knobs which you can rotate, and then the tip of this tube can rotate, look at the pictures of this inside the stomach region from different directions. Okay, so it has like 2 degrees of freedom, and these two knobs basically transmit the most rotation of these knobs through some cables all the way to the end. There is also a channel which is called the biopsy port through which you can send an instrument like this. Okay, so in this instrument, there is a long thin wire, and at the end of the wire, you can have something like a grasper or a scissor or something. This is very small. It's about 3 mm diameter. So you can push this, and then when you are looking at and you see something of interest, you can take a sample. Okay. The other end of the endoscope, which is here, which is what we will look at in more detail a little bit later, okay, what we want to modify. There is a way to project light using some fiber optic cables. Okay, fiber optic system. And then we have a lens and a camera which you can take pictures. There is also a channel to inject water and air, because when you are putting this endoscope through your mouth and in through the GI tract, there could be some food or some other particles, things there. So when you see that, you can inject some water or air to remove it so that you can pass through it. Okay, this whole thing is about 12 mm diameter. The lens is approximately 5 mm diameter, and this is about 3 mm diameter. Okay. So what are some of the problems in current endoscopy? It is very difficult to position the biopsy forces forceps accurately. Okay, so as you can see, there is this biopsy forceps. So something is coming out of here, which is extending a little bit. Now, if I want to position this, I have to move this whole head. Okay, I have to move this whole head using this control heads. Okay, these two knobs. But when you move this head, the view also changes. Okay, so the camera is seeing something else and the view changes. The tube is also very, very less stiff. Okay, so it is of low stiffness. So if when you are projecting this grasper, and if you want to move it, it will not position very accurately. So in summary, what we have is we have very little control in positioning the tip of the endoscope or the forceps. Okay, it is mostly used for diagnosis. So you can take pictures, so you don't need to position very accurately, which you need if you want to take a sample. A lot of skill is required to take these samples or to position this biopsy forceps accurately. However, we have only a very little time. Okay, we have a few minutes to do this task, because when something is put through your mouth, you tend to vomit or you tend to gag. Okay, and you want to throw out the things. So there is very little time. So although they put anesthetic and things like that, but nevertheless, you cannot keep the endoscope inside your GI tract for too long. And as a result, there is very little scope for surgery. Ideally, we would like to do some small minor surgery, not only take samples, but maybe do some surgery there. Currently, it is only used for diagnosis, primarily for diagnosis, but we want to take samples, we want to do surgery. Okay, so if you want independent control of the forceps without moving the entire endoscope, okay, we need to have very small actuators. So as I said, the whole endoscope head is 12 mm. The channel through which you send this instrument is 3 mm. Maybe you can increase it a little bit, but you cannot increase it too much. Okay, so we need very thin, small actuators. One option is to use what are called shape memory alloy wires. Okay, shape memory alloy works that if you heat it by, say, passing some current, it will contract, it will move, it will actuate something. Heating is very quick, but if you want to move it again next time, you have to cool it back to some temperature, and that takes too long. So shape memory alloys are not very useful. We cannot, of course, have motors. You know, it is very, very expensive and complicated to have motors and transmission which can move through this small channel. Okay, maximum about 3 to 5 mm diameter is available. Okay, so we need some actuator which can be used to position that grasper or the forceps independently of the head of the endoscope. Okay, what are some of the advantages that we have? We need to move the tip very small amount. We need to move in a small 3D region. So something of the order of 2.5 centimeter diameter sphere on the surface of a sphere. But we need fine motion control. We need to move it a little bit, but accurately. The other big advantage is we have visual feedback available. So there is a camera which is looking at whatever you are doing. So you can correct if you are making a mistake. Okay, if you are going in the wrong direction, you can correct it. So visual feedback is very important, and it is available already. So what we proposed in our robotics lab is to use what are called miniaturized pneumatic artificial muscles. Okay, we want to make the endoscopic attachment independently actuated, and the actuator that we have chosen is this miniaturized pneumatic artificial muscle. So we can get these tubes which are made of silicon and then braided with a much harder cable or a net-like material of the order of 1.2 mm. Okay, so it is reasonable, you know, we want something like 5-6 mm diameter entire assembly. Our actuators are now 1.2 mm. The important thing is this actuators can contract when pressurized by up to 20%. So basically, initially the tube looks like this. This is the silicon tube with some braiding of a tougher material on the outside. It is of L0. When you pressurize it, it will contract to some LF. Okay, so that is what is happening. So and I want to show you as a video. So this is this miniaturized tube. We are going to pressurize it with air using a syringe. One end, there is a small load to keep it straight. Okay, and then you can see what happens. So when you are pressurizing it, you can see that the yellow end of one end is slightly moving backwards, and you can see how much it has moved when the pressure is released.
Enough.
Okay.
And the displacement is very small for someone to see it. Now do once more.
So as I mentioned, it can contract by up to 20% of its length, okay, which is quite wet, and the pressures are also not very high. We can see that the pressure which the student is applying is basically whatever is there in a syringe. So first thing is we need to make a mathematical model of this contracting tube of this miniaturized air muscle. Okay, it is called muscle because like muscles, these things contract when you apply some force or pressure. Okay, so we made several mathematical models. Some of the elements of the mathematical model is we assume it to be a thick cylinder. Okay, the diameter of the tube is quite small and the silicon material is also approximately of the order of the diameter. So we cannot use traditional thin cylinder models. We also need to apply some boundary conditions because the braid does not expand or contract when you pressurize it. It is also very hard to find what is the contact area of the braid because this wire, this nylon wire, is wound around this silicon tube. At some places there is no wire. So what we did was we used two experimental data points to estimate the parameters which are the contact area and some other things. Okay, and then we looked at if I apply some pressure which is some 0 to about 800 kilopascals, we see what is the deformation of this tube. Okay, as same as the experiment, so you can measure the deformation. So if you have a 40 mm long tube and then when you pressurize it to, let's say, 200 kilopascals, the experimental value is this dark value. There is a band, which means this is the mean and these are the variation around the mean. It's of the order of 5 millimeters. Okay, and as you keep on increasing the pressure, after a while it saturates. So for example, at 800 mm, it is like 800 kilopascals, it is like 11 millimeter is the contraction in a tube which is 40 mm long. So the plot of the experimental values are shown in this dark colored with a bar. And then like anything, that many people have worked on this. So they have various models of this miniaturized tubes, okay, silicon tubes, contracting when you apply pressure. So there is a Schultz, Chow, Hannaford model, which is this green, okay, and that is predicting much more than what the experiments are showing. There is a model given by Kothera or Liu Ran, okay. So all these are very close to that, but nevertheless, there is a difference between experiment and the model what it is predicting. We developed a model which is this triangle, okay, purple color triangle, and you can see that this model is very, very close to the experiment. Okay, I don't want to go into the details of the model, but basically we used a thick cylinder model. We put some proper boundary conditions because of the braiding. Then we use some experiments to estimate the area of contact and so on. And as you can see, at different lengths, this is for 40 mm, this is for 60 mm. Again, here, our model, which is this inverted triangle, okay, purple color, is very close to the black, which is the experimental value. The others are a little bit far away. Okay, so we have now a mathematical model which appeared in this ASME Applied Mechanics Review of a pneumatic air muscle, okay, miniaturized pneumatic artificial muscle when you apply pressure. So this model is required because we need a model to, if you want to do control later on, okay, we need to know how much pressure to apply such that this much contraction happens. Okay, we cannot keep on using experiments. So once we have this mathematical model, we have some good idea as to how much it will contract when you apply pressure. We use three such tubes arranged 120 degrees apart. Okay, and we made a CAD model of our actuated forceps. So this is the forceps. There is a holder here and there is a initial holder here. In between that, there are these three artificial muscles. Okay, there is a spring on the outside because the spring helps in bringing it back. Okay, there is also an inner spring which also gives some stiffness. So this inner and outer spring gives some stiffness to this whole assembly and helps in bringing it back when you release the pressure. There is this tube through which you apply, which you supply air, okay, and then there is this one central tube through which you can send, and at the end you can have forceps or any other tool that you want. Okay, so we developed a CAD model consisting of, let me repeat, three MPAMs, miniaturized pneumatic artificial muscles, arranged 120 degrees apart. If you actuate one, two or three at a time, it will move. Okay, so for example, if I actuate the top one, this one will contract and this tip will go upwards in one direction. If I actuate two of them, then the tip will move in the resultant direction. We can also vary the air pressure inside the tube and make it move less or more because the contraction depends on the air pressure that you give. So basically what we have this three and we can actuate one, two or three, all three at a time, and then we can make it move on the surface of a hemisphere or a surface of a sphere. Okay, so this CAD model was implemented and this is how the hardware looks like. So this is a little bit bigger than 5 mm or 6 mm. Actually, this is more like 7 mm which we constructed. So there are these three, then there is this grasper, and then there is a small tube which you can actuate this grasper, and this whole assembly can move on the surface of a hemisphere, okay, when you actuate this artificial muscles, when you pressurize these artificial muscles. Okay, and how do we model where it will go when you actuate these muscles? So there is something called as an elephant trunk model in kinematics of continuum robots or flexible robots. So elephant trunk model consists of that there is an arc from S equals 0 to L. Then there are these artificial muscles. Then there is a backbone. Okay, so this backbone is more stiffer. So the backbone is that inside spring. So when you actuate this muscle, because this muscle contracts, this backbone will bend. Okay, so there are these parameters of distance from the backbone, okay, A, and the, which we know, and then based on these parameters and this equation of this backbone, we can estimate where the tip is. Okay, so it turns out this elephant trunk model gives a reasonable estimate of where the tip should be. Okay, except some portions are straight, here everything is elephant trunk. So if you account for all these small variations, we can estimate where the tip of this forceps or the grasper will be when you apply air pressure using this elephant trunk model. Okay, it turns out the error is about less than 5%. Okay, so we now have a model which tells you if I apply pressure, how it will move and where it will move. Okay. So we built this device which I showed you, and I'm going to show you two videos of this device being actuated by air pressure. So the air is coming through these tubes, and I will show you two views. So from the front, how it moves, and from the side, we can see how this actuated end effector moves when you pressurize the air. And as you can see, the scale is between 0 and 30 mm from both sides. We want to move about 2.5 centimeters, 25 mm. Okay, so let's show this video. So the motion of this end can be seen more clearly because we have put an LED at the end. So front view shows this LED. And as you can see, as you pressurize and give different air pressure, as well as actuated either 1, 2, or 3, all three at in some order, this head will move, the tip will move. So I can move in any direction, basically on the surface of a sphere from the center. And the movement is roughly about plus minus 2.5 centimeters, maximum displacement. This is small displacement, but it is more than enough. Okay, in this, inside the stomach, we don't need to move much. Although not shown in this video, the motion was actually controlled by a joystick. So when you move the joystick, okay, then this actuated end effector moves in the direction of the joystick, and then you can apply more or less pressure also. Okay, so the video will play for a longer time, but I'm going to stop here. But the basic idea is by applying air at pressure in these three tubes, I can make it move in any direction on the surface of a sphere. Okay, now let's continue. Let's look at another way to actuate a very small end effector. Okay, and instead of using air, we want to actuate an end effector using cables. So what we have here is a flexible backbone, which is this central backbone, And on this backbone, there are these disks with holes. Okay, so through this hole, you can pass a cable. Okay, so these are wires, thin, very thin wires. Okay, and as you pull this wire, this whole structure will bend. And the basic idea is that if you have several such cables, and if you pull these cables in a proper way, we can also make the end move on the surface of a sphere, or can even trace a curve on a surface of a sphere, okay, by suitably choosing which cable to pull. So for example, this one shows four cables. So if I pull this cable, it will bend this way. If I pull this cable, it will bend this way. If I pull this cable, it will bend towards you, and so on. Okay. So there are various ways to send these cables. So this shows a straight cable routing, meaning that each hole is on one on top of the other and the cable is straight. Okay. So first thing is, how do we model such a system? So there are various modeling techniques which are there in literature. There is something called as a Cossorot rod model. I'm not going to go into the details of that. But these green dots shows how the Cossorot rod theory predicts when such a flexible backbone with disks, and when you pull this cable. Okay. So it's just reasonably accurate to the actual experimental data. We developed another technique called optimization based model. So basically each link here, so this one pair between this point and this point and this point and this point can be considered to be a four bar linkage. And then one of the links of this four bar linkage changes length when you pull the cable. And this optimization based approach is using this four bar linkage. Okay, the Cossorot rod model uses many other parameters, basically the E value and the Young's modulus and various other values of this backbone. We don't use that. We will use only the geometry of this linkage, this four bar linkage. And we also developed this optimization based model, and then we compare with the Cossorot rod model. Okay, and also the experiment. So you can see here, this is how experimentally it looks like when you pull it. The dark blue is our optimization based model. The light blue is the Cossorot rod based model. For the cable also, the location of the cable which is passing through this hole, where should the cable be based on optimization and based on Cossorot, you can see that they are very close to each other. Okay. We can also extend this model when the cable is not straight, okay, meaning that it doesn't go from one hole to other hole all the way straight. We can go from the first hole to the second, and then it can be twisted, so it can go to some other hole, and we can have what is called as a general cable routing. Okay, so the cables are not straight. So when you pull such a cable, the shape of this backbone is different. So you can see it is bending like this and then bends in some other direction when you pull this cable. So again, the theory should be able to predict what is the shape of this backbone, okay, where these points are. And as you can see now, the optimization Cossorot rod model and the actual things are deviating a little bit. Okay, so our optimization, which is dark blue, which shows where the center of this backbone should be, the disk center and the where this backbone is attached to the disk, it is closer, okay, to the experiment. Likewise, what is the location of the cable, how the cable will twist, or where the cable point will go, connection point will go, again there is some difference now. And we claim that our optimization model is more accurate sometimes. Okay, it is not everywhere, it is not that good or bad. Okay, here the Cossorot rod and our optimization is very close to each other. Okay, so whereas here it is slightly far, and this our optimization is closer. So this is a work in progress, but we are developing this flexible robots which are cable driven. Okay, and this whole backbone, and these discs are 3D printed. It is very easy to assemble, and although it is slightly bigger right now, but we can hope to make such robots which are very small and actuated easily. So as you can see, depending on the cable routing and the number of cables, I can move the tip in some desired path. Okay, and the goal is to find a relationship between the path of this head tip and how much to pull the cable. It is also desired to find out what happens when you have different cable routing. Okay, what is the shape that this flexible robot will take? Okay, so this is, as I said, this is a work in progress, but I'm going to just show you what the students, Soumyakanti Mahapatra and Ashwin, did. So this is a 3D printed cable driven continuum robot with generally routed cables, modeling and experiments. Okay, what all we can do? So what is being shown is there are three of these thin cable driven backbones. Okay, and we can use it to grip an object. So for example, we can grip a sphere. Okay, and then pulling the cable or pulling the cables in differently, we can make the sphere move also. We can manipulate the sphere. So the next example is these three cable driven flexible robots gripping a cube and then making the cube move in some way. Okay, so these black patches are nothing but some soft sponge so that it can hold the cube or the ball properly. Okay, they are not, it is not sticking to it. So as you can see, when the fingers are moved apart, this white cube, cube will fall. So what I wanted to show you is that we can have this flexible robots which are consisting of a flexible backbone with discs through which you pass cables. And then when you pull the cables, this whole flexible backbone will bend, and you can now have three of them to grip an object and make it move to a desired position or desired orientation. So I'm going to stop here. So in conclusion, endoscopy requires use of flexible robots and mechanisms. Okay, normal endoscopy, I cannot position the end and do any surgery. I can at most look at the GI tract or look at the stomach. But if I want to position, I need stiffness. I also need independent control of the actuated end effector. Okay, so we can use what are called as miniaturized pneumatic artificial muscles. Okay, they are very thin, very small. We can make a model of this miniaturized artificial muscles. And then when you pressurize these muscles, they contract. And using three of them, I can make the end effector, which is the grasper or some other tool, move independently of the head of the endoscope. Okay. So we can model these MPAMs. We can even control these MPAMs by suitably adjusting the pressure and sending the pressure to which of these three tubes. Okay. So what the goal is, we want actuated flexible endoscopic end effectors. Okay. Which we can independently control for surgery or biopsy tool. Okay. We can also make flexible robots driven by cables. And I have shown you a work which is in progress where three of these flexible robots with the flexible backbone and discs, we can, by pulling wires or cables, we can make this flexible robots move. It can grip an object and you can position and orient that object.